The Old Testament reading for this, the 16th Sunday after Pentecost, is taken from the prophet Ezekiel, the 33rd chapter. God said, "Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel. So hear the word I speak and give them warning from me. But I say to the wicked, O wicked man, you will surely die, and you do not speak out to dissuade him from his ways. That wicked man will die for his sin, and I will hold you accountable for his blood. But if you do warn the wicked man to turn from his ways, and he does not do so, he will die for his sin, but you will have saved yourself." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is taken from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 13th chapter. Saint Paul writes, "Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities. For there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. You want to be free from fear of the one in authority? And do what is right, and he will command you. For he is God's servant to do you good. If you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword for nothing. He is God's servant, an agent of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also because of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes. For the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to government. Give everyone what you owe him. If you owe taxes, then taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For he who loves his fellow man has fulfilled the law. The command is, do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not covet. And whatever other commandment there may be, are summed up in this one rule: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is taken from St. Matthew's Gospel, the 18th chapter, beginning with the 15th verse. Jesus said, "If your brother sins against you, go and show him his fault just between the two of you. If he listens to you, you have won your brother over. But if he will not listen, take one or two others along so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, treat him as you would a pagan or tax collector. I tell you the truth, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three come together in my name, there am I with them." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us.
Mercy to thee, O Lord.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Tolerance. Tolerance seems to be the word of the year. It's the central message seen on the media, on the news. It's taught at colleges and universities. on social media. We are to tolerate those who think and act differently than us. In fact, not only are you to just tolerate them, but you must agree and accept them wholeheartedly. That is what they mean when they say to tolerate and to love someone. And if you disagree at all about anything, then you are deemed as hateful and should be cast out of proper society. To love is to accept. However, the readings that we read here today give us a different picture of what it really means to love our brother. To love does not mean to accept and approve of every single thing that your brother thinks and acts, even if it's wrong. To love doesn't even mean to just tolerate it and to put up with it. No, what we see in the text today is that to love your brother is to go to him and correct him of his sin, that he might repent and be forgiven. It's a tough thing to do, but it is the loving thing to do. And it's something that Jesus has been teaching in his word up to this point in the text. When looking at the message of Scripture, it's important to look at the whole context that a text is put in. And our gospel lesson this morning is no different. What comes right before our gospel reading is Jesus telling the parable of the lost sheep. In this parable, a shepherd has 100 sheep, but one of them wanders off and is lost. So the shepherd leaves the 99 and goes to find the one lost sheep. He searches and searches until he finally finds the sheep. And when he does, he takes the sheep home and rejoices that he found the lost sheep. There are good themes in this parable, and they are to be looked at in the text for this morning, this gospel text. The first of those themes is that the man goes after the lost sheep, and then he goes as far as into the mountains to find the sheep. He goes after the sheep because it's part of his flock, and that's who he is. The shepherd protects his flock, so he goes and searches for the sheep. He cares for them. But he could have easily said, well, 99 is a lot of sheep. No one's going to miss just one sheep. 99 is just fine. But he doesn't say that. And he doesn't say that because he loves his sheep, each and every one. And so that's why he goes to find it. And Jesus has the same view of the church. In this parable, the sheep are our Christian brothers and sisters. And when one of those brothers or sisters sins and falls away, we are to seek after them and bring them back. It won't always be easy. Just like the shepherd had to go into the mountains, the rough terrain, in order to find that sheep, it's going to be difficult to confront your brother or sister. But we are told to do so because Jesus desires all of his people to be saved. The second theme is that once the man finds his sheep, he rejoices that his sheep is found and not lost anymore. He's not concerned about the number of sheep that he has. That's not why he goes out to find this lost sheep. And when he finds the sheep, he doesn't scold the sheep for running off. No, he finds the sheep, and he rejoices that he found the sheep because he loves the sheep, each and every one, and desires them all to be in his flock. Jesus, likewise, doesn't want any of his children to fall away from him. The motivation of his searching and calling us is love, love for us. He cares for us, each and every one. And that's why Jesus says in the text, if your brother sins against you, go and show him his fault, just between the two of you. If he listens to you, you have won your brother over. The goal here is to win your brother from sin. For to turn him away from sin is to save him from eternal suffering. And this is where the modern message of tolerance breaks away from Scripture. They claim that loving others by accepting their views is what love is what tolerance is, to just accept, even if it's harmful to them. But is that really love? To let your brother continue doing something that is dangerous to their salvation? You've probably heard the analogy of the blind man walking towards the edge of the cliff. Is it more loving to say, to see this blind man and to say, well, if that's what he wants to do, then I accept it, and let him walk off the cliff? Or is it more loving to go up, grab him, and pull him away from that edge and save his life? The answer here is clear to us. And it's clear in the Scriptures as well. The Old Testament reading speaks exactly to this. Ezekiel writes, when I, God, say to the wicked, O wicked man, you will surely die, and you do not speak out to dissuade him from his ways, that wicked man will die for his sin, and I will hold you accountable for his blood. Now, this passage is kind of scary. And it's especially scary because it's so easy to see your brother sinning and to just let him go on and do it and not confront him on it. You've all done it. You see someone doing something that they shouldn't be doing. You know it's wrong, but it might hurt your friendship if you confront him on it. Or it might just be uncomfortable for you to have to go to that person and say, what you're doing is wrong and you should repent. And that's what the world wants you to feel. That's what the world wants you to do, is to just let them do what they want. For that's what loving is. But Jesus teaches differently. He teaches that the Christian, when he sees his brother sinning, walking in that destructive life, should not just let him go, but go to him, confront him, urge him to repent and be forgiven. And this process is not just a one-time thing. Jesus doesn't say, go and meet with your brother once, talk with him, but if he doesn't listen, well, you gave it your best shot, so let him go. No, he doesn't say that. Jesus says, but if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. And he doesn't stop there. He continues. He doesn't say, well, you brought someone else, so yet that's as good as you can do. No, he continues and says that you should tell it to the church. The reason he continues this and treats this so seriously is because he knows that sin is a serious issue. And salvation of your brother is a serious issue, for we know where a sinful life leads. And that is why Jesus continues to urge us, to urge our brothers who are sinning, to repent. But why even bother? After all, they probably won't listen anyway, right? Jesus speaks to this as well. The reason we confront our brother and to bring him out of that sin is because that is exactly what Jesus has done for us. To go back to the analogy of the blind man, you were that blind man. You were blinded by your sin, and you you were walking towards that cliff of death in your sin. But Jesus saw you. Jesus, the one who truly loves and cares for you, didn't just tolerate your sin and let you walk to your own demise. He loved you. And because of that love, he grabbed you and pulled you back from that cliff of death and saved your life. He saw his lost sheep wandering on the earth, and he desired to save them. He came down from heaven and became man. He preached repentance to his people that they would turn from their sin. He continued to seek after his people even when they rejected him. And ultimately, he went to the cross for you. He suffered and died in the place that you deserved, because he loved you and cared for you and desired for you to be saved. He is the good shepherd who gives his life for his flock. And all this he did not do just to glorify himself and make himself look good, but he did it for you because he loves you, each and every one of his flock. And that great love is the reason that we are to seek our brother when they fall away into sin. We know the punishment that we deserve because of sin. And in turn, we also know the great saving work that Jesus has done on our behalf. Therefore, we continue to tell our brother to repent so that he may be forgiven and be saved. But we don't do this alone. We don't act by ourselves. Jesus is still the one who saves. Jesus goes on to say in the text, "For where there are two or three gathered in my name, I am there in the midst of them." Throughout this whole process of going to your brother, confronting him of his sin, urging him to repent, and if necessary, keeping him outside of the church, Jesus is there in the midst, working among you to save that brother. He is the one doing the saving work, and he is constantly at work in and through his church. For it is only through Jesus, by his grace, that any erring brother can return to the faith. Only he has the power to do that. And so that's a great comfort to us, that when we see our brother sinning and we urge him to repent, that it's not just our skills or our cleverness or our power that brings him back to that faith, but it's Christ who works in and through us. He has done the work, and he continues to work through us. While the world shouts the message of tolerance, Jesus teaches us what true love looks like and what true love means. To love someone is to work for their greatest good and to keep them from harm. That is precisely what Jesus did for us on the cross, calling us out of darkness and into his light. We see this perfect example of love and are taught by Jesus that we too should seek after our brother when he falls away. Love is the motivator behind Jesus' command to go and seek after your brother. Love is the way that your brother will be saved and brought back to faith. Love is the reason that we are saved. And it is that love that gives us the sure hope of eternal life with all believers in Christ. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard our hearts and minds.